In the words of the African American griot, Gil Scott Heron, it's winter in America as we await the blizzard that's about to engulf us tonight at 6 o'clock. I want to remind you that on this campus, beginning in October with the race themed parties, Taco and Tequila, we have been snowed under by a blizzard of white racism. The student organization Transforming Oppression and Privilege, STOP, is beginning to show us a way of how to deal with that phenomena in real life terms. Our speaker today will talk about ways to deal with the rise of anti-black violence and racist discourse in a broader context. W.E.B. DuBois, one of the originators of Pan-Africanism. This is the 10th annual W.E.B. DuBois Pan-African Lecture. It is an activity that is jointly sponsored by the African American Studies and Research Program and the Center for African Studies. DuBois was not just an originator of Pan-Africanism or the notion that all people of African descent need to unite. He also believed in the unity of what he called the darker races, and he was an early feminist. It is this aspect of DuBois that our speaker, Dr. Joy James, will connect with and relate to the ongoing struggle that we're experiencing today. Joy James is one of the foremost scholars in Africana studies, in feminist studies, and interdisciplinary studies. She is, in the best of the black tradition, a scholar activist, a person who doesn't simply use their scholarship to engage the critical issues of the day, but more importantly, she puts herself out there on the line engaging those struggles. And again, she epitomizes the type of scholar that we want young students to be transformed into, the scholar activist. She is the author of so many books, so many important books. I'll mention just a couple. Transcending the Talented Tenth, which I think is a kind of foundation point for a talk today, and of course the Angela Davis reader. Let us welcome Dr. Joy James.
Good afternoon. I think I'm mic'd, right?
Yep.
Okay, cool. Get away from this. Thank you very much for inviting me to spend some time with you this afternoon. And I came in last night, and I very much appreciated hearing about STOP and all the activism that's been happening around campus, but also the intellectualism pushing for a greater understanding of what humanity could be despite the failings that often afflict us. And, you know, send out some good energy towards me because I keep hearing blizzard, and I have to leave in the morning. But Gil Scott Heron, right? Winter in America. That was so timely. Thank you. And what I want to talk about today, the larger title is Democracy in Captivity. And my argument is, or my observation, or my offering, right, is that there's been winter here for an incredibly long time, that there hasn't been democracy in what we call the United States in the absence of captivity. Since the late 1700s, when the state of Virginia codified slavery as being restricted to those who wore the black body, right? No longer, you know, would it be coupled in the same kind of exploitation that white indentured servants from Europe or Native Americans would bear the burden of. But there would be a specificity to this exploitation, that it would have the captive imprint on it, and that this would be part of our legacy, right? And that our ancestors, you know, who've worked with us, who struggled with us while here on this side, and then when they cross over, that so much of their intellectual contributions have been shaped by confronting democracy in captivity, the sort of false ideal that's been set up, and which the so-called parasite worn by the black body has actually been the prey of a larger predator, right? Both in terms of economic exploitation, in terms of political disenfranchisement, and in terms of the existential wealth. This is a phrase I got from Cornel West when I was in seminary with him, the sense of existential wealth where whiteness can have a currency, right? Not quite as good as a platinum card all the time, maybe, but that you can use it to cash in on a certain type of privilege. Maybe Stop is dealing with this, right? At the expense of those who don't will the currency. And so that there's a complicity, even when you think you're neutral, even when you think you're a bystander, even when you think this is only about entertainment and jokes. There is a complicity in degradation. And it is not only the captive body that is degraded, it's also that of the captor. So the talk then begins with W.B. Du Bois and also Ida B. Wells. And I think she's one up. Is there an echo? Does that bother you? No. Okay, now I was joking earlier, I haven't gotten bifocals yet. So I'm gonna like try to do this without, you know, going back and forth. I'm interested in two things here, actually. The way in which voices deal with anti-violence campaign in terms of historical narratives, and I call them ancestral voices, but also the ways in which contemporary activists also pick up these campaigns. And there's a new anthology out titled What Lies Beneath, Katrina, Race, and the State of the Nation. And I was asked to blurb it, and I was so impressed by the contributors, you know, activists from New Orleans, academics from other parts of the country, feminists, people with critiques of the economy and exploitation, but also critiques of the state and the abandonment, that I asked to do an afterward. So the second part of this, the first part is ancestral voices and anti-violence campaign. The second part is actually a reading from the afterward. And I want to share these with you. The proceeds of the sales go to rebuilding Katrina. So maybe you would share them among yourselves. And of course, the book I'll be leaving with your program, Cindiata, for you and your students if you have interest. Okay. Ancestral Voices in Anti-Violence Campaigns, Democracy in Captivity, and Remembrance of W.B. Du Bois and Ida B. Wells Barnett. This is Wells with her manifesto, Southern Horrors, Lynch Law in All Its Phases, that was published in 1892. But first we'll begin with the foundation of our tradition in a lot of ways, who gave us many contributions and a number of contradictions. So from W.B. Du Bois, his 1920 essay, The Damnation of Women. The uplift of women is, next to the problem of the color line in the peace movement, our greatest modern cause. When now two of these movements, women and color, combine in one, the combination has a deep meaning. And this quote from his 1920 essay, The Damnation of Women, which appears in Darkwater, Voices from Within the Veil, W.B. Du Bois cites three great causes, as you know, the struggles for racial justice, peace, and women's equality. His use of the phrase next to does not refer to a sequential order of descending importance. Racial equality, international peace, and women's emancipation combine to form the complex integrative core of Du Bois's analysis. With the politics remarkably progressive for his era and ours, and this is what I've written about, you know, a decade ago in Talented Tenth, I want to start with and then move on from there. Du Bois confronted race, class, and gender oppression, linking the struggles to end racism, sexism, and war with international peace and justice struggles. In this essay, The Damnation of Women, Du Bois, of course, also condemns female domestic exploitation, sexual assaults, and he argues about this despoiling of motherhood and also despoiling of virginal status, that this is what the culture has particularly in store for black women. It can be argued, of course, that Du Bois extends this analysis to all women, and I would say in the 21st century, we could also say, as with the historical precedents, that it's not just motherhood that's despoiled, right? It's also fatherhood, that in this split of gender roles, you have the performance of certain types of restrictive behavior, either with patriarchy, the performance of domination and control, or with certain forms of female subjugation, the performance of docility and obedience. So the constriction crosses against or crosses beyond gender lines. And a deeper reading of The Damnation of Women would acknowledge that it's not just the rescue of women that we're after, it's the rescue of sexual beings, it's the rescue of an understanding of gender roles that could be healthy as opposed to conflictual, combative, and commodified. Now, so in The Damnation of Women, he heralds women. They're on a pedestal. There's something to be championed, something to be rescued. But there's also something else at work in Du Bois's writings, that it's the women in his fictions, it's the women as the suppressed other that need the greatest attention felt by him to be of need in terms of attention and redress. But the actual women who organized alongside of him, and maybe we can go back to his peer, she's one, two ahead. You'd go for it, yeah? That his actual peer and co-radical, co-activist, Ida B. Wells, was someone to be diminished largely to a footnote. So you see, it's almost Pygmalion, right? The women you create are the women you hold up for view, the women you champion. And then you get to be a crusader of sorts, right? A rescuer of sorts. The women who have the intellectual power, the political savvy, the radical passion to match you as peer are the women that somehow get relegated to a footnote. Somehow you don't recall their endeavors, you don't recall their contributions. So I'm not arguing that Du Bois was not a feminist. As you pointed out, he was. My argument is that maybe sometimes feminism needs to have a cautionary label, right? So like anti-racism, you know, buyer beware or co-participant beware, that those who have status or privilege might in their need, felt need to rescue you, somehow bury you deeper into the mire by their inability to acknowledge a co-equal in struggle. And so what suffers not only are those interpersonal relationships or political alliances, what suffers and what is diminished is the political struggle itself in its totality, because all are needed with the fullest ability of their contributions. When you think about then Du Bois and Ida B. Wells struggling against racist violence, trying to confront captivity and democracy as they understood it, you know, a century ago, you see that it is racist violence that becomes the radicalizing impetus that pushes them into another realm. You know, I'm going back and forth in this dialogue between Du Bois and Ida B. Wells. Indeed, lynching's a spectacular form of racial violence, transformed Du Bois, publicizing him into a militancy that left the Harvard PhD ill-suited for academic society and liberal institutions. Du Bois' dark water short story about lynching, it's called Jesus Christ in Texas, and you kind of get where he's going, right? If Jesus came back today and he landed in Texas, it's like a pre-Bush era, you know, observation, but he would have a very hard time in terms of being received and treated. So this is a lynching fictional story for him, Jesus Christ in Texas. And here it speaks to his profound pessimism concerning racist violence in the United States. Two decades later, Dusk of Dawn describes how racial atrocities haunted his early adult life. He writes, quote, "Lynching was a continuing and recurrent horror during my college days from 1885 through 1894. 1,700 Negroes were lynched in America. Each death was a scar upon my soul and led me on to conceive the plight of other minority groups." So early on, he thinks of coalitions, right? That it's the black body that seems to carry the brunt of the burden of stigma and racial excesses and atrocities, but there are other racialized figures on the landscape. The pressing need to confront racist violence furthered Du Bois' disaffection for an alienation in academic life. Maybe we could talk about this, you know. For those of us, sometimes we feel like we're waiting for early retirement, because academia constructs itself as a corporate environment with a managerial ethos, right? And so there's a disciplinary mechanism that goes on continuously. So we're pulled to it by our so-called love of the life of the mind, by our passions to think critically and independently, by our desires to contribute, right? But it reflects in many ways the larger society. Managed dissent, quell a certain kind of inquisitiveness, right? And promote conformity. So what we struggle with in 2007, Du Bois grappled with, you know, over a century ago. Du Bois writes eloquently of his first encounter with lynching. Quote, "There cut across this plan which I had as a scientist, a red ray which could not be ignored. I remember when it first, as it were, startled me to my feet. A poor Negro in central Georgia, Sam Hose, had killed his landlord's wife. Having drafted a careful and reasoned statement concerning the evident facts for publication in the Atlanta Constitution, DuBois was then en route to deliver his editorial to the newspaper, and he recalls, quote again, "I did not get there. On the way, news met me that Sam Hose had been lynched, and they said that his knuckles were on exhibition at a grocery store further down on Mitchell Street, along which I was walking. I turned back to the university, shaken and galvanized," end quote, shaken and galvanized by this close proximity to a lynching victim. DuBois writes that thereafter he resolved that, quote again, "One could not be calm, cool, and detached scientist. One could not be a calm, cool, and detached scientist while Negroes were lynched, murdered, and starved." So there was something about the reality of our existence, about our vulnerability, about our proximity to racial terror that complicated the academic endeavor or the retreat into the ivory tower. During racial unrest in Atlanta, in fact, DuBois sat on his doorstep with a rifle in his lap, and Ida B. Wells herself, who vowed to sell her life dearly after it was threatened when she wrote an editorial condemning lynching in Memphis and also questioning the mythology of the black rapist. She herself traveled with a pistol in her handbag. With these two, she also, like DuBois, seems to have been radicalized by the worst forms of violence, but radicalized into a shared militancy that recognized their vulnerability, a shared militancy that acknowledged the right to self-defense, a shared militancy that acknowledged a vulnerability that could look for coalitions with others. But somehow what they shared in terms of their vulnerability and in terms of their militancy would be not be enough to continue this alliance between these two formidable activists. So if we look at Ida B. Wells Barnett and her own right, we see that in 1892, she was politicized by the lynching of friends and colleagues in Memphis, Tennessee. In fact, Thomas Moss was the father of her godchild. And what happened at the time in the South, and this is why Ida B. Wells's work is so instrumental, and it's so unfortunate that DuBois didn't understand the need to acknowledge that. But what happened in the South in this particular era is that political emancipation, economic competition, and these are sort of the highlights of American democracy, of course, were criminalized for blacks. And so when Thomas Moss and his associates opened a people's grocery store in Memphis, in competition with the local white grocer, the white police in plain clothes came to the back alley at night with guns and did not identify themselves. In that era, the black men inside holding a business meeting assumed that they were about to be turned into prey by racial predators. And so there was an exchange of gunfire. People were wounded. The men inside gave themselves up, expecting who knows what from a law and order society. But eventually they were lynched. And that then was due process at that time. And it was then that you saw, and it wasn't the first time that one would see it, but it was then that Ida B. Wells saw clearly that the right to self-defense had been criminalized for blacks, that the right for economic competition had been criminalized for blacks, that the right to political autonomy had been criminalized for blacks, and later when she wrote an editorial that the right to freedom of speech, or the First Amendment right in terms of freedom of expression. So before this lynching, right, and this is her parallel with DuBois, before this lynching, if you read her memoir, Crusade for Justice, she writes that she actually believed the myth of the black rapist, right, the super predator, right, the super criminal, who stalks the prey of the virginal white female, right? But it's a mythology that's an equal opportunity moment, just like our racial mythologies today about black criminality. Remember what you heard about New Orleans? All the rampages that were supposedly going on? And so the rescue mission became a criminal, you know, thing to be quelled, or the rescue mission became a police operation to quell a criminal population. Not people who had been abandoned, and as they wrote on the walls, and I'll read a bit later, abandoned and left to die. So in this culture where we're all invited to partake in mythology, racist mythology, whether it's about our romanticism and our ridicule of Native Americans, or Latinos, Chicanos, or Asians, or Arabs, or Blacks, or women, or gay, lesbian, transgender people. In this cauldron, everybody can dip for a sip, right? Everybody can sort of imbibe this naturalized culture. And so Wells shouldn't be condemned or criticized for that early belief. But it was the atrocity when it hit home that had her then leave that belief behind and move into something else. And what she moved into was an incredible radical, a sense of radicalism organized really by Black women. Black women in Brooklyn, New York in 1892 organized a gathering to raise money to pay for the publication of Southern Horrors. They raised $500. And this part of the Negro or Black Women's Club movement became a foundation for the anti-lynching campaigns, right? So Frederick Douglass had spoken out against lynching, you know, W.E.B. Du Bois would, but it was Ida B. Wells who made a turn into it in a certain kind of bold endeavor, with a certain kind of risk-taking fearlessness that I argue, and so have other scholars, led to her marginalization. Not just her marginalization in the greater culture, in the larger society, that was almost a given, right? But her marginalization among Black elites. Now, Ida B. Wells and W.E.B. Du Bois belong to this formation called the Talented Tenth. I spoke earlier today, and I wrote about it in Transcending the Talented Tenth, that the Talented Tenth encompasses a number of people in this room. It's an idea that was popularized in 1903 with Du Bois' Souls of Black Folks, right? And people know what the Talented Tenth is? Is that mm-hmm or no or what? Yeah, so you're not mic'd, so I can't ask you because I couldn't hear you, but so you do know, and you know that it's this elite race leadership, right? You know that it was popularized by Du Bois, but it was not coined by him, the phrase. The phrase was developed by the American Baptist Home Missionary Society in the late 1800s. And these were white philanthropists who saw what happened with the end of Reconstruction. Not just the emergence with incredible fervor of the Klan, right, of racial terrorists on the landscape, or the rise of lynching, or the convict prison lease system, right? But what happened was the possibility, what was happening was the possibility of returning to a sense of destabilization of the social order that had been paid for dearly through the Civil War. Du Bois notes in Black Reconstruction that some 200,000 African Americans have fought in that war. So the Talented Tenth, on one level, looks ideal because it's the model that we're all to aspire to. That's why we're at the university, right? That's why we're obtaining degrees. That's why we're becoming professionals, so that we can perform or live or witness as a model of racial uplift for the other 90%. But there's a problem with the Talented Tenth. Sorry. And that problem with the Talented Tenth, I don't know why I'm speaking in this as if it's on, right? The problem with the Talented Tenth is that it's also a buffer zone. And the American Baptist Home Missionary Society understood that. They wanted a buffer zone between that 90% being terrorized by the Klan, being lynched, being exploited, being politically denied the right to vote, having the full brunt of a democracy born in captivity, right? They want a buffer zone between that 90% and white society. And who better to fit the wedge but the Black elite, right? So, and one way white society could look at this elite, they could look at you, they could look at me and say, oh, look how well they've done, you know? I mean, they talk like, you know, they perform in the way in which you would want a bourgeois society with democratic idealism to unfold in its claim to be beyond an apartheid state and not have a genocidal logic in its anti-Black racism. But in another way, it quells dissent from below, right? Because it's a hierarchy. And so when you have Du Bois and when you have Wells and this contestation between them, the conflict, it's not just going to be about gender. It's going to be about a certain kind of practical organizing. Where do you take your cues? You'll see this decades later with Ella Baker in the civil rights movement. Ella Baker kept getting fired by the NAACP. She just, like Martin Luther King fired her. She just kept moving through these organizations because she was not loyal to the institution. She was loyal to the mass. And my argument is that Ida B. Wells dealt with not only the sexism, right, not only with anti-radicalism in its general framework, but also she split ranks with the Talented Tenth. In some ways, she betrayed the logic of the American Baptist Home Missionary Society, Henry B. Morehouse. Morehouse College is named after him. Spelman is named after Laura Spelman, a Rockefeller, right? That to create these schools in the South as a buffer zone to provide race models, but also to quell dissent. And it's her split from the Talented Tenth in a way, to be docile with the understanding that was put out in 1896 by those people who would never live at the base, would never suffer the atrocities that the base suffered. It's her departure from that, I believe, that actually led to, in some ways, her disassociation from W.E.B. Du Bois. Now, it wasn't voluntary on her part, and I'm going to kind of speed ahead so I can get to part two. So I'm going to bring the ancestral voices and the anti-violence campaign narrative to a close soon. It wasn't voluntary necessarily on her part, because she helped form the NAACP in 1909, right? But her name was left off the call of the organizing committee, and she faults Du Bois for that in part. But again, I'm not just focusing on gender, because later she will be marginalized outside of the club movement by Mary Church Terrell. So you have black elites, and it's not that she's actually from the base herself, right? She's also middle class, however that's constructed in that particular moment. But the way she thinks is definitely tied to a mass base, right? So that her being ostracized is again an equal opportunity affair, this time not about race, but about gender, that both men and women can push away the perceived radical as destabilizing, as a troublemaker. But I argue, and so have many, however we want to define radicalism, I don't know how stop, you know, if they're liberal, if they're right, whatever you call yourselves. But Ella Baker understood it as meaning to go to the root, right? To not gloss over, to not have a cosmetic response to crisis, but to actually try to dig down to the root and understand these intersections of economic exploitation through capitalism, of racism, specifically white supremacy, and of misogyny in the culture. Wells is not the only one who has a lament, and the lament is not a moment of self-indulgence. In my understanding, a lament is this moment of sorrow, when you recognize you gave your best effort, and somehow things didn't turn out the way you had hoped. But if you have the long view, and I hope the ancestral view, right, that we're even talking today, that you even came out to hear about Du Bois and Wells, means that in many ways they triumphed. So I close on this note of Du Bois, and then I'll go to the reading from the volume on Katrina. Du Bois popularized the notion of the Talented Tenth in 1903. In 1909, he wrote the biography of John Brown. According to David Rodiger, that was his favorite book, right? That it was a white revolutionary who got martyred for the 1859 raid on Harper's Ferry that Du Bois was enamored with. And being enamored, you know, maybe it's a bad dance, one step, two step back, who knows? But for Du Bois, there was something about John Brown's fervor. There was something about the militancy that resonated within him, even though he had ambivalence about the radical strategies of others. If you increasingly read Du Bois as he matures, in some ways he echoes for me Martin Luther King. You can say there was an early Martin Luther King, right? Civil rights, you know, hamburger, desegregation, accommodations, whatever. There was a later Martin Luther King, anti-war, anti-imperialism, critique of capitalism through the Poor People's Campaign. You can say the same about Malcolm X. I think you can say the same about all our great thinkers and intellectuals, that you start at one point and you struggle and you see the response, because there's always a counter response, there's always a backlash, there are always these moments for co-optation, right? And then you evolve if you choose to evolve, and that's what leads you to become great and leads you to become an ancestor. So if you read Du Bois's biographies, you'll see to this point when he breaks from the NAACP that he offers his own lament, that he did not have a fellow radical or fellow radicals that had a critique of the base, their need for economic sufficiency, the understanding that legalism and liberalism could be Trojan horses for us, right? Could promise something that they could not deliver. And so in that way, even though they're in these separate spaces, he and Ida B. Wells come closer together. And my offering then to both of them is to read from this afterward, from contemporary voices, mostly young voices. This is the interesting thing, you know, about being on the planet long enough to see different struggles and to participate in some, the anti-apartheid movement, movements against police brutality. And I think that we would reach a certain point and realize that the points move, they're mercurial, right? It doesn't mean that there's no progress, but, you know, sometimes, you know, all of us, I think, have our own regrets about what we weren't able to achieve. But what pleases me or nourishes me so much in this book, this anthology, What Lies Beneath Katrina, Race, and the State of the Nation, is the way that young people articulate the next level of struggle. Young people define what constitutes political literacy and what constitutes a struggle for democracy by severing it from captivity. And here is the afterword. Begin with a quote from Ida B. Wells Barnett, Mob Rule in New Orleans, which was written in 1900, which appears in this publication. Quote, "We do not believe that the American people who have encouraged such scenes by their indifference will read unmoved these accounts of brutality, injustice, and oppression. We do not believe that the moral conscience of the nation, that which is highest and best among us, will always remain silent in face of such outrages." Ida B. Wells, Mob Rule in New Orleans, 1900. Read three images. A Monthly Review photograph of a tank with armed soldiers, actually members of the state police tactical unit, who with their assault weapons pointed down or slightly up, just looking like armed soldiers, patrolling the streets of New Orleans while black residents outside of shelter of, quote, last resort, end quote, call out for help. The second image, a Reuters photograph of uniformed white men, actually I think we have this, if you scroll down a couple, of uniformed white men disciplining, maybe go up one? Yeah, it's this above. A Reuters photograph of uniformed white men disciplining black men sprawled face down on dry concrete, the white men patting down and surveying the black men who've been stopped in their efforts to flee catastrophe, men marked as carjackers. One officer positioning a foot inside the door of the postal vehicle he has just rescued. The caption, which does not appear here, reads, "Texas game wardens watch over people who were caught using a mail truck trying to escape New Orleans. They were freed but forced to continue on foot." Read the third image. And we've all seen these perhaps, right? The image of a white couple wading through water with groceries juxtaposed with the image of a young black man wading through water with groceries. Their respective captions identifying the white couple as searching for food and the black man looting for his. Read three images, speak three words, shoot to kill. Redundant death or overkill is mapped onto black New Orleans so strongly that most are silenced or speak feeble responses to the realities of institutional abandonment, neglect, paternal contempt and caretaking, and state and social violence before and after Katrina landed. Witness those who walk in and through a city turned urban graveyard, first moving and floating, then drying in mire, struggling to gain a foothold and to voice a literacy that counters denials and executioners' commands levied against those, quote, left to die. I went last March with my students, and we stayed in the common ground space, and survivors wrote there on a chalkboard in the St. Mary's Middle School. They had sought refuge there from the waters flooding the Ninth Ward. they left us here to die, and in honor of that, nobody's erased it some year and a half later. Challenging silence on the state's responsibility for death and social instability, this anthology, What Lies Beneath, Katrina, Race, and the State of the Nation, creates space for vocal, politically literate voices, the heirs of W.E.B. Du Bois and Ida B. Wells. The images and language of post-Katrina New Orleans, like that of post-9/11 United States, inspire new voices, such as those presented here and elsewhere in terms of organizing throughout the country, and an infusion of radicalism into common sense or everyday politics to promote literacy relevant to crises where deadly domestic and foreign policies increasingly intersect. A quarter of the Louisiana National Guard, as you know, was absent from release efforts due to deployment in Iraq, where over 600,000 Iraqis, according to a John Hopkins study, and approximately 3,000 U.S. citizens have died since the U.S. invasion. Of course, this was written in November, December, so the numbers go up. This volume provides us with a grammar book shaped by previous battles for justice, love, and safety for self and community. It's a grammar book that I argued in that first part that our ancestors have written. The voices represented here, whether native New Orleanians or not, build a foundation to resist dehumanization, and so in part function as not just voices of Katrina, but voices for the nation. And also they reflect the echo of historical narratives that frame and shape the meanings of current trauma, dislocation, and death. Litany for Survival, Part 2. Months before I traveled to New Orleans searching for a litany for survival, and of course that phrase comes from Lord, I reached for Ida B. Wells' writing on lynching and police brutality, assigning mob rule in New Orleans to my students as a grammar book on anti-black racism and social and state violence. Vilifying and policing, containing and punishing black bodies seemed more important to state officials than saving black lives in the days and weeks during which state officials and media sought to interpret and assign blame for human loss and man-made or compounded disaster following Katrina. That the state placed abandoned survivors under a shoot to kill edict, to criminalize their right to survival, left some of us momentarily speechless and required more political literacy and critical voice than that readily available through the language of conventional politics. As Governor Kathleen Blanco and President George W. Bush drew a bullseye target around largely black survivors we had witnessed trying to survive and some failing and so dying, without assistance from a state to which they swore some allegiance or belonging. Remember, there was a woman who, a number of people who would claim, we're American too. Words drew me and destabilized me until I realized that I had to translate my disgust and distress into political literacy. It was not human suffering per se, but suffering accompanied by repression, embedded in the injunction of death for the resourceful who didn't want to roll or rot in misery, that radicalized me into seeking more voice. Literacy transports us into politics, not always coherent or seamless. Radical literacy is at best alive to possibilities for change and social transformation, possibilities for resistance. Resistance may start in crisis as it did for Du Bois and Wells in terms of lynching or racist violence. If you reach a point where the state, by its own rhetoric, promises to use lethal force against responsible people who are trying to prevent their children, themselves, or others from prematurely dying or needlessly suffering, then you're at a crossroads. Here, the moment of crisis is compounded by the government so that it seems logical to suggest, given the shoot-to-kill decrees, that good or responsible or competent black parents and community-minded survivors secure bulletproof vests before seeking, that is, looting, bottled water, baby formula, and Pampers, or before taking vehicles to flee danger, or having been stripped of technology at gunpoint by game wardens from an adjoining state, before attempting to cross bridges on foot into surrounding parishes, only to be turned away at gunpoint by state officials. And the continuity of blacks in crisis amid the discontinuity of ecologically and manufactured disasters, will it matter if we're called Americans rather than refugees? When and where is nation state membership a passport that possesses tangible value in terms of mobility and survivability, a value that state and civil society must respect for bodies first and foremost recognized as Black and impoverished rather than as human? And who or what can demand, maintain, and enforce that respect when it has been denied? Struck by and drawn to the voices of historical Black mothers trying to keep their children alive and healthy in earlier eras, I hear the continuity of contempt for Black humanity amid the discontinuity of epochal disaster and warfare, and the reliance or the resilience of resistance. In Ida B. Wells and Mamie Till Mobley, a literacy and voice encourage hope and struggle for viability and independence despite institutions that promote premature death and misery through neglect and punishment. Ancestral voices are able to give a literacy that comprehends death edicts coded as law and enforcement or law and order mandates to be something other than isolated phenomena. The voices of past radicals provide a legibility that enables us to read and then act against the mapping of oppression onto our everyday and extraordinary realities, that is to act against democracy wedded to captivity. State-sanctioned death and dying, overkill for the Black frame, have historically been features of U.S. official and unofficial policies towards racially fashioned subjects, the stated or understated enemies to be contained at home and abroad. Policing rhetoric and practices include the visceral, scarred Black civilian bodies from the murderous force used in the Danziger Bridge tragedy, in which police engaged in a shooting spree of innocents as they sought snipers, self-deputized posses, white citizens grinning as they described to Spike Lee on tape their stockpile weapons for shooting people, I think they meant Black people, in order to protect their property. And Lee quips, I don't know if you saw the documentary that aired on HBO, do you remember that moment he asked the guy, the homeowner gives him this inventory of all these guns, he's like, are you hunting bin Laden here, you know? Southern Horrors, part three. When Howard, a former member of the New York City chapter of the Black Panther Party, drove me through the lower Ninth Ward in March 2006, I saw how 21st century traumas evoke 19th century terrors. In the lower ninth, post-Reconstruction lynching described in Southern Horrors resurfaces. Here, though, only clothes flutter in tree limbs. Here, the dead haven't left bodies behind to be cut down and buried to shock the living into mourning. Here's just the suggestion of departed frames in shirt sleeves and pants legs swaying in breezes or hanging limply from branches, clothing not retrieved months or years after they rooted in the trees of the lower ninth. Can there be lynching without a formalized lynch party? Is Billie Holiday's strange fruit the predictable harvest from an apartheid-like city-state left with paltry resources whose impoverished and outcast have been left to die? Survivors straggle back by any means necessary to a beloved city and problematic city where the majority outside of the institutional power never traveled from home to counter the narrative that they were strung up and are dispossessed. They may read not only a history of repression and resistance into themselves, but themselves into history, right? As there's a fast forward of shared identities, from slave codes mutating into Black codes and Jim Crow, lynching, the convict prison lease system, and current prison mandates, the historical legacy of Black expendability amid racial, economic, and political exclusion. In March, when Howard pointed out that the exterior walls of homes propped up on or pushed off of their foundations had been turned into tombstones by police agencies, funeral markers in the absence of funerals, I had to read again. Not the absence of agency. Agency existed. People were resourceful, found their loved ones, tended the traumatized, buried the dead, worked to rebuild lives and communities. Radical literacy is not a victim narrative or a mere lamentation. So what was underneath what the police had written on the walls? I read policing mechanisms that sought to destabilize Black agency and autonomy while constructing graveyards to serve as staging ground for real estate emptied of, quote, undesirables, end quote. So the NOPD, the New Orleans Police Department, the TFW, the Texas Fish and Wildlife, the National Guard and others spray painted an acronym, the alleged date of entry into or onto the building, the number of those found alive, the number of dead bodies retrieved, and then encased their quartered codes with a circle to be read clockwise. The deeper we drove into the ninth, the more painted funeral markers, absent funerals that dignified death, and the longer the wait time before, quote, help came. The waters came in August 2005, but the state did not, at least for the ninth ward. While Howard drove slowly through neighborhoods, I began to see entry dates for the ninth, the 10th, and then the 12th months of that year. Mourners from the ninth ward would say later that the colorful police tags and graffiti were part truth and part fiction. Police claimed to check homes that they never entered, as unfortunate relatives later discovered when they found unrecognizable corpses. If the state waits months before the waits months after the waters recede, why claim to enter at all? Is this a performance of accountability and care? Surely the pretense of rescue takes place on stage, while the concreteness of relief is tossed to private charities or outraged activists and compassionate individuals or resilient people who claim New Orleans is their own. Birthplace, hometown, future. The rescue or abandonment of the living or the remains of those who meet or fail to meet the test are determined by federal, state, and local entities. And then I go on to talk about Mamie Till Mobley and what she offers in terms of the use of the funeral of Emmett Till in the open casket. And I ask the question about whether or not New Orleans is actually our open casket. And are we willing to look inside into a mutilated space, into an alien distorted figure, and recognize it as familiar, as one of our own? And I would say that the legacy of Ida B. Wells, the legacy of W.B. Du Bois, gives us the stability, gives us the insight to look and to act. Thank you.
Dr. James, let me first say I loved your chapter in 17 Conversations. Okay. My question is, you had spoke earlier about, when speaking about Ida B. Wells and Du Bois, about the internalization of white supremacy. And my question is to that is, to what extent do you think that both Du Bois's and Ida B. Wells' radicalism is based on a certain type, if you will, of resigning moan. And to explain that, I know you know what that means, but to explain that is in certain respects, in particular in the works of Du Bois, like say the passing of the firstborn, he has this whole notion, or if talking about some of like the benighted black folks or his racial kindred, as you talked about, in the with the other 90%. And so to the heart of the question is, at what level do you think that in some of the activism for those people who occupy this talented tent is based on this supposition that one, those who are under them aren't able to do it, and then also to how much of this is based on their dealing with white supremacy and the understanding that at this particular time that they're not even wanted. And so, because then just to finish this point out is that to me, I would argue that at the time and when he's writing, Du Bois is probably the brightest person on the planet. Not just the brightest black person, but the brightest person on the planet.
Yeah.
And so at that particular time, when you have someone who is the brightest person on the planet, of course, we know his credentials first, black PhD from Harvard, et cetera, et cetera. And people like Cornel West said that, you know, for all black intellectuals, the W.B. Du Bois is the brook of fire that we all must traverse. So given that, and not to exclude Ida B. Wells from this as well, given all of that, at what level do you think that speaks to the pervasiveness of white supremacy and how that in some ways, even if a Du Bois can internalize this and have these particular things in the passing, and Ida B. Wells, you talk about how she initially herself have these issues of the degenerate and deleterious characterizations of black folks, What do you think that is the implications for us today in light of when you talk about us all being kind of the heirs in the academy of that in some of those divisions?
All right, thank you. Well, as you were speaking, it just came to mind, you know, actually as critical as I am of the academy, I'm also appreciative. I mean, because their programs, such as the one of the African American Studies program, are critical centers for thinking around gender and race, you know, economics, you know. Without those centers, we don't have breathing space to actually deprogram ourselves, right, from these larger ideologies that just have this incredible currency and get recycled in so many ways. So yes, in some instances, Black intellectuals, the talented 10th, are imitative, right? Because the dependency model to be a ward of the state, you know, the American Baptist home missionary, like DuBois writes it, what does it mean to be a problem in the 20th century? We can ask that about the 21st. Hopefully we won't have to ask it in the 22nd, right? But this notion that you have this population that is inept at taking care of itself, and so it's infantilized. And if it's infantilized, it needs a parent, which means an authority figure, right? And it isn't going to go through a maturation phase. You know, like you have your little 2-year-old or your 3-year-old daughter. I was just saying earlier, I've met so many wonderful people here, but including men who reinvent fathering and parenting, right, as a non-patriarchal act. But in raising your child, you hope that one day you can just take a break, right, and step back. And you did your job because they're evolving to share peerage, right, to have some peer status and to function as citizens in civil society. With an infantilized group, you don't take a break, right? And so it becomes what, you know, the cliches are about white man's burden, however you want to do it, talented 10th burden, you know, so on and so forth. But it's the pathologizing of sectors of society which have brilliant people just like Du Bois. They're just not going to go to Harvard to get a doctorate, right? And the economy, despite its mythology about boots and bootstraps and, you know, Velcro, whatever, the economy is not functioning for full participation, just as the political realm is not either. So when we internalize this notion of being elites who have a nobility, an inherent nobility, because we're going to serve others, it presumes two things, what Du Bois later figured out are not true. One, that we actually want to serve a mass, and two, that we're actually competent to do so. And I would argue that's true about the larger society. When people are going to rescue women or rescue Blacks or rescue whoever you want to rescue, without the full participation of their political insights and their radicalism and their insights and their wisdom, that's a bad shell game. That is self-serving. That places you on the pedestal where you claim somebody else is sitting there, that you're championing them, and then you become the martyr. And that's where, you know, it gets confusing. Who's the predator, who's the prey, right? Because on one level, it's assumed that the predator are the impoverished classes, they're the racialized classes, they're the uneducated classes. But what if the privileged sectors actually pimp off those formations for either existential wealth or identity constructs of being these great benefactors and rescuers, or just the sheer exploitation, right? So the last 8 years I've been doing work on incarceration in prison. And neither W.B. Du Bois nor Ida B. Wells actually dealt with the rise of the convict prison lease system, where you died faster than you did on the plantation. And there are, you know, historians have written about this, you know, academics. Matthew Mancini's one dies, get another, you get it, right? So it's a joint venture between private industry and the state. And what are the crimes? Well, Blackness has been criminalized. Yeah, you can rob and, you know, kill and rape. I mean, all the horrible things that afflict societies, right? But that's not necessarily the reason why you go to prison. And that wasn't the charge necessarily during the convict prison lease system in the post-Reconstruction era. So refusing to step off the sidewalk when a white person wanted to pass, economic, you know, competition with white businesses which led to the death of Wells's friends, meant that you could be arrested, put in the penitentiary, and the penitentiary would turn around and sell you to mining, agricultural, forestry. There was no incentive to keep you alive, so they worked you to death. One dies, get another. So plantation life, you actually had longevity, right? And if you don't have a critique for that, like the contemporary leadership, whether they're Black, white, Latino, Native American, if you don't have a critique for what happens at the base,
thanks for your talk. And I wanted to kind of use this question of the Talented Tenth as a kind of bridge to kind of, again, segue between two areas of your work that maybe take us back into this question of incarceration. You write about how the Talented Tenth, the idea of the Talented Tenth, was really radically challenged for Du Bois when he had the experience, in a sense, of experiencing state violence when he was incarcerated himself, and how that was kind of a transformative rupture moment for him in terms of creating kind of a radical consciousness to stop looking at this idea of this constructed notion of an elite and start to look for the strength of, in a sense, the working class as the basis for kind of transformative change. And I use that as a segue to try to get inside some of your work today, which is looking at kind of incarcerated Black intellectuals as kind of this radical space of Black formation, and how that may offer us a new way of thinking or trying to deconstruct power as it operates today by going to that very space that in some ways Du Bois had an inkling from through his experience through state violence.
Right. Du Bois's proximity to being a political prisoner was going to be tied to the McCarthy era in the 1950s, and his increasing interest in socialism and communism, right? And so the way in which Paul Robeson and other figures, to some extent Ruby Dee, Ozzie Davis, and now are celebrities, right? Entertainers, celebrities, right? Artists. Du Bois almost found himself in that trap, and he writes in one of his memoirs that it was not the Talented Tenth that came to his aid because they were afraid to. Because they were invested and they felt they were going to lose too much, you know, access, jobs, respectability. But it was the trade union movement. It was workers, organized workers, that made an intervention. And so pulling from that, and also I had a postdoc for a year with Angela Davis on the West Coast in the 90s when I was just coming out of grad school, I became increasingly interested in those people who had radical critiques of democracy and captivity, of oppression in the United States, and who acted on those critiques. And I ended up, over the last 8 years, editing anthologies by incarcerated intellectuals. And most people think that intellectual formation happens in these sites, because this has a stamp of approval. This is where you're supposed to come to read and learn and write and think critically. Well, people also do that in prison. And they may actually think critically about us in ways that we don't think critically about them. So if the majority of people are incarcerated, there's some 2.5 million in the United States, we have the largest captive population in any industrialized nation in the world. Right? If the majority of people are incarcerated for nonviolent drug offenses, if 70% of the incarcerated are people of color, if 50% of those captive are Black, you have to ask how they got there in some ways. So just as a start before we get to the intellectual formation. And how they get there, in part, is the bias in sentencing. So that if you commit a crime or infraction drug-related, according to the Washington, D.C.-based sentencing project, you're 8 times more likely to be incarcerated than a white person. The majority of those who consume powder cocaine are, you know, I asked my class, they all know this, I don't know why. You know, people, it's like, who's the senator from this? Nobody knows, but the majority of people to be incarcerated for powder coke are which population? Yeah, and not just white. This is when it works, when you just start parsing it. Not poor white people, not Appalachian white. You're talking suburban whites, right? And according to the Sentencing Project a couple years ago, suburban affluent whites edged out Blacks and Latinos for crack. But the majority of people who are going to go to prison for nonviolent drug offense will be Black and Latinos. not white suburbanites. So if you really want it, let's do the pairing here, right? If you really want to talk about lynching and who is the greatest predator of white women, and you believe in crime and punishment, the majority of people swinging from trees would have been white men. It wasn't just white women, it was Native American women, it was Latinas, it was black women, it was like everybody, because they were also the caste that formed the sheriff, the police apparatus, and the judicial system, right? If you wanna see your prisons overflowing for drug offenses, the majority of people inside that would be your roommate in college, right? Or, you know, your stockbroker or somebody. You know, it would be your administrator, your dean, did you say that? It would, I don't know your dean, so he didn't say that. Okay. Oh, no, I wasn't pointing to you, I was pointing to the general area. So you get my point. Now, if people who are captive inside have to think critically about that and we don't, do you think their thinking might have a certain depth to it that ours won't achieve? Because the very questions, and this is what made Du Bois brilliant, he had to address questions that most people would ignore, but they were foundational to the understanding of what we call American democracy. And captive populations, right, just to stay alive, just to survive, and sometimes just to stay sane, have to address issues that most people can overlook because they feel that they are protected by this society. Even its dysfunctionalism, even its bias. If you kill a white person, you're 4 times more likely to get the death penalty, right? Which, you know, in the Constitution, it's that 3/5 clause, you were 25% now? You know, your value's plummeting. But there's a way in which democracy has these turns to it, and I make these jokes because if not, you can get swamped under the grimness. And it's a kind of humor that I also get from people inside. And there's a way in which brilliance and satire can be useful. You don't have to be the joke when people want to dress up into what they think is a stereotype of what you are and perform with some kind of like self-indulgent, narcissistic display of white supremacist endeavor or acting, you know, probably bad acting, whatever. You don't have to be the joke. You're not the joke. But your satirical edge and your insight can actually point to the flaws in which there are two choices, democratic communities or supremacist culture. I mean, really, there seems to be only two choices in my mind. And for me, the imprisoned intellectuals who were buried underneath, I mean, even editing the anthologies were difficult, because John Ashcroft, after 9/11, put my contributors, a number of them, in lockdown. And they'd included Berrigans, you know, the pacifists, plowshare activists, Isaiah, the passage from Isaiah, where we'll beat our plowshares, I mean, see, our swords into plowshares, we'll study war no more. They included white anti-imperialist activists such as Marilyn Buck, who will probably die in prison in California. And they included Black Panthers, who'd been incarcerated for decades. Nobody had any links to Al-Qaeda. But the point was to show that the disciplinary power of the state could reach incredibly far. And nobody would even pay attention to it, right? But people inside pay attention, and what they write about is what we live because they were outside at one point, and they know what we live. They know what it means like to love, to be separated from loved ones, to have parents die and not be able to attend funerals, right? Yeah. They know captivity. And Frederick Douglass writes about this, Orlando Patterson writes about this when he talks about the Greek chorus of slave women. It's those who are shorn of freedom in the most absolute sense, or the most violent way in which they're stripped of freedom, who probably have the greatest insights into what freedom might be, the very possibilities, right? That the absence creates a presence, at least on the level of the mind, and a desire for that. And so that's why I think imprisoned intellectuals are so important to read.
Thank you for your talk. My name is Brian, and for my work, I look at varieties of American identity, and there's an ambiguity that I'm hoping you can help me to understand better, and that is these kind of disconsonant images of I.W. Wells, somebody who picks up the pen and is trying to arouse the moral consciousness of a nation, but on the same hand, keeping a pistol in her bag because right. The right to life has been criminalized, you know, for her And I'm also thinking of somebody like DuBois, writes brilliantly, as a previous questioner had said, you know, one of the most brilliant human beings of the past century.
He actually said the.
But also spending the last year of his life literally outside the system.
Right, in Africa.
And you know, grooming something like Nkrumah to overthrow white colonialism. And so the ambiguity that I'm hoping to understand better is the side of the mind that says, let's work within and try to expand the idea of a civic democracy, make the system work better for everybody. And the other one that says, we're so far out of it, maybe we need to start thinking of, like, you know, things like armed self-defense and really adopting a more radical and revolutionary, because they sometimes seem to exist in the same mind and the same writer.
Right. Well, the thing is that the struggles are so complicated, right, that there is no formula for success. So you can't say in an absolute way that, you know, armed struggle works or even that pacifism works. And I draw my cues in part from Ella Baker, right? That when she was working in the 1940s, I mentioned she'd been fired by the NAACP. It's because, I believe, was it Harry Moore, whose home was firebombed in Florida for, and he was NAACP activist. He's trying to, you know, register people to vote. And he and his wife died. In fact, they just found his briefcase in an old barn and returned it to his daughter, you know, decades later. Nobody went to jail. It's like Emmett Till, you know. Certain people don't do time, right? But Ella Baker's fired because she asked the community, what do you want in Florida? And they said, well, actually, we need weapons because we're dying. It's people just coming in and killing us. We can't go to the local sheriff because, you know, there's these relatives, you know, they're related to the Klan. Mm-hmm. Wells writes about that in her own work, right? These lynch parties, and there's the sheriff and the judge, you know, and lynch parties are draw up to 10,000 people. This is my criticism of Foucault's Discipline and Punish when he says torture ends at some historical moment. But you, like, 10,000 people picnicking and people taking body parts home for souvenirs. And in the face of that terror, you ask people what they want and they say, we need protection. And the state does not offer it. So we need to protect ourselves. And she helps them to organize this campaign around self-defense that Robert Williams will do later in Monroe, North Carolina in the 60s, and the NAACP fires her. But later she ends up being the first real coordinator for SCLC with Martin Luther King. So it's this ability to have flexibility, you know, this fluidity, that depending on the moment and the need and the crisis, that you can respond in a way that seems responsible and accountable at the time. Now, most people will not engage in armed struggle for anything because the costs are so incredibly high. And perhaps one reason that I became drawn to the political prisoners is that I'm the product of a military family, like with a father who was in Vietnam, and just got to grow up with the contradiction of these black officers who are invading the Dominican Republic. Now let's go to Korea. You know, it was just like imperial time, so they were moving from space to space. And how they satirized their employer. All the time they reaped the benefits of it, right? So I got braces. I got the equivalent of private school on military bases, which were going to be better schools than you would find in a segregated South at the time, right? So they accrue these benefits, and they're participants in violence as employees of the state, right? We live with violence all the time and the contradictions all the time. It's just when the out-groups think about countermeasures that somehow it's like obscenity. And how so? I mean, if you're going to be anti-violence, then just be consistent. You know, just straight across the board. And I can respect that. Completely straight across the board, you're pacifist, whether it's your understanding of Buddhism or Christianity or the Torah, whatever your spiritual faith takes you to this principle stance, that's totally understandable. If, though, you have an allegiance to a repressive state, and because it has criminalized certain forms of dissent, then to prove your patriotism or at least your obedience so that you don't become a target, if that becomes the impulse behind your condemnations, then I don't see where the integrity is in that. at all, actually. That's why I was in reading that piece, I said that Blanco and Bush drew a bullseye target around black people who had no weapons and who just needed baby formula, some of them. Yeah, right, some people were taking TVs and went, I'm fine, you're gonna carry that through water. I mean, that's what you need to do. But you know, and you know, but the sniping reports, the rape, I mean, those were all, they were largely fabricated. There was some violence, but it was minuscule. If white suburbanites on the Upper East Side had been abandoned, no one would assume that they would go on a rampage of killing and raping. It would be, how do we get them water and food? And how do we move them to safe space? But if a certain kind of other body has been abandoned, what is this culture? The knee flex reaction is that it's a criminal population. That means you're criminalized despite your behavior. Now, how do you want to respond to that? I mean, what do you want to do about that? And if some people choose other means or other mechanisms, you know, I give these talks about prison sometimes and policing, and people say, the gang warfare, and you're right, it's horrible. And the rite of passage for black and Latino youths and tattoos, that's true. But for me, consistency is acknowledging that there's a rite of passage for white working class youth. It's not just about economic means of poverty that you enlist. It's a rite of passage to find your manhood. Listen to some of their oral testimonies. NPR is great in heralding the war, and like, they interview people and they talk to their parents, and I'm not going to trivialize that, you know, because my father's dead. I mean, he basically suicided. It took him a while after he came back. So if you want to go into a war zone, yeah, the consequences are intense. But there are white men who also seek the adrenaline rush, and white women too, and people of color. So there's a way in which violence is just very familiar with this culture, but then at moments when it's politicized, somehow we're stunned, right? We're stunned that the captive would ever think about returning fire. You know, Henry B. Morehouse was concerned. I mentioned 200,000 people fought, black people fought. That means they were armed. And part of what you had to do in the abortion or the end of Reconstruction was confiscate that weaponry. And I feel I should end on an up note of reconciliation because if not, there are no other questions. So what, for me, democracy and captivity is meant is that there are many strategies and approaches, but as intellectuals, we're able to sit with the variety of them without a knee flex rejection from any particular sector as doing the unthinkable and its demand for being able to survive. And not just survive, but thrive. Thank you.